Welcome, everyone, to GNU Presents Performance Feast. Artists and community, who's ready to feed your mind and nourish your heart? We seek to expand our grassroots community of connected artists by engaging in artistry-focused conversation. This series is made possible by the voters of Minnesota through a grant from the Minnesota State Arts Board, thanks to a legislative appropriation from the Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund. Tonight's special guest is Tyley Ross. Tyley Ross is a singing teacher, vocologist, and musical theater actor. Tyley got his first break in 1994 as a singer-songwriter while busking on the streets of Toronto. Since then, his energy and talents have earned him a Grammy nomination as a recording artist, Canada's Dora Award for Outstanding Performance in a Musical, and a master's degree in vocal studies from London's Royal Central School of Speech and Drama. Tyley is a co-founder and lead singer of the Universal Records Recording Act, the East Village Opera Company. As a vocologist and voice coach, Tyley specializes in the science and practice of voice production and rehabilitation. Now based in New York, he teaches private voice at NYU's Tisch School and is the on-site vocologist at the NYU Langone Voice Center. Please give a warm welcome to Tyley Ross. Hi, Tyley. And GNU's artistic director and Performance Feast host, Bo Field. Some housekeeping for the evening. You can change the view of your Zoom to side by side up in the right, up in the top right corner of your screen to see both panelists and the screen share at the same time. The chat function and Q&A will be available. When using the chat, please make sure to send to all panelists and participants. Take it away, Mo.
Hello, one and all, and welcome to another episode of Performance Feast with the one and only Tyley Ross. Hi, Tyley.
How you doing, Mo?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
Awesome.
Good to have you here.
It's so great we've got to be here.
A bunch of people that are going to be watching us do our thing.
Awesome.
And to those folks out there in viewer land, if you're new to Performance Feast, we're going to watch a bunch of our favorite videos that we are going to rap about, and we're going to pick Tyley's brains, see how he can help us become better performers. And you're most welcome to be here. Write your questions in the chat. We'll try and, you know, involve you as much as we possibly can on a webinar. And yeah, so Tyley Ross. Now, Tyley and I go back, in full disclosure, we go back to the 90s, which is kind of fun and cool, like we're still both alive and here. It's good. But I want to show you a little bit about what Tyley does, because Tyley is pretty amazing. And if you don't know who Tyley Ross is right now, you're definitely not going to forget him when you're finished seeing a little bit about him. So let's just jump right in and show Tyley doing his thing. This is the East Village Opera Company.
La donna è mobile, qual più malvento.
that was just a little shot there. We didn't play the whole thing. You want to tell us a little bit about your project?
That project, that was the East Village Opera Company. It was born out of a film soundtrack that, boy, this sort of goes back. It's got a snaky kind of origin. I was hired to do a film to star opposite Ernest Borgnine. And I was asked by the directors, like, you sing, do you sing opera? I'm like, yeah, I sing opera. And I never sung opera.
Right.
And it turned out that I had to sing opera in this thing. So I had to learn a couple arias to sing in this movie. And once it was done, I had a couple records out at that point. And so the director said, why don't you just make like an opera record and I'll use it as the soundtrack to the film. And I was like, yeah, I'm never going to do that. And then he wrote down a number on a piece of paper and he said, this is what it's worth to you. I'm like, I can figure that out. So he introduced me to a guy who became my collaborator for 10 years, Peter Kieswalter, who's an extraordinary arranger. And we, neither one of us were steeped in operatic tradition. And so we thought, what if we did these songs the way these composers might if they were alive today and had electric guitars and drums, microphones, the ability to program and record? What would they make these songs sound like? They were composers who were trying to push the limits of what an orchestra was able to do, and they were all looking for influences from around the world. So we thought for sure, I mean, Mozart would have been playing an electric guitar for sure. And so we're just, you know, we kind of, Queen was a reference that we ended up a lot, like that song, the chorus is a
right.
bit of a Queen ripoff. But anyway, we had a 10-year career. We had three albums and got to tour to most places in the world and were nominated for a Grammy Award at one point for that as well too. So yeah, it was a great time. Yeah.
What a fantastic thing. And you know, taking a song, like, did it hurt you to put that into 4/4?
No.
It's easy to do.
No, it's pretty easy. It just
perfectly.
Once you just sort of stretch the time a little bit, it feels a little bit awkward because it really is. It feels native in 3. But once you finally learn it in 4, then 3 feels somehow quaint. But
right.
We knew, actually, we thought that we would really upset a lot of the opera folks. But in fact, we were invited a couple years in a row to perform at the New York City Opera Gala. And and we did one of our album release parties at Lincoln Center. So I think most opera lovers still have Hendrix records and more, you know. So I think people really liked it. For them, it was for our audiences, it was liberating, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Very liberating, yeah. For sure.
And the musicianship of our band was, you know, off the charts. We got to choose from the best in New York City and people that are still extraordinary musicians. So it was a real pleasure. Yeah,
can't really go wrong with that.
Yeah.
So for the people watching, I mean, this is you really playing around with a lot of style. We're going to watch another video of Tyley showing us how he goes through the different styles. But do you want to speak a little bit to some of the challenges as a vocalist and the care that you need to take while you're switching from style to style, even within one piece of music?
Yeah. I think about the different styles that we're in as almost being in a kind of condition. I think about it sometimes as the way a dancer might, if they are a ballet dancer who needs to be extremely tall versus a modern dancer who might hold their body in a certain way versus a hip hop dancer or a Russian Slavic dancer who holds their body in a very different way. And it enables different things to be possible. Mm. And so you need to be conscious of that when you are moving in between styles, that you have appropriately changed the oral posture and the configuration of the subsystems of voice in order to be ready. And when I say appropriately timed, I mean that it has to happen before you start singing. And maybe that's in the breath between singing that way and singing this way. But really that, when I talk about oral postures, like how do we align all of these movable bits of throat And then how do we use and drive those for lack of a different way? But singing rock and roll can feel fun, but if you then go to from sort of a screamier kind of mode of singing to something lighter, more lyric, something that requires a little bit more connection through the passaggi, that's a bad order in which to lay them out. I typically, in a show like doing the East Village Opera Company, I would always lay out the show going sort of from lighter lyric stuff to getting rockier at the end, because at the end, once you're right. kind of raging, then it kind of, it opens up and it works well like that, but it's not gentle on the chords. And then yeah. the chords that have been sort of beaten around don't really like taking a lyric trip again, you know, they don't work as well. So I always start light and then move rocking, which is when you say the challenges also to extend, when you're on tour, you know, you might've gone light at the beginning of the first night and you end rocky. Well, you get a bad sleep and a bad plane yeah. trip. And then you land at your sound check. Basically you get a bad meal, despite the best efforts of the promoters, and you start hoping to go light, but you're already singing on chords that are swollen from the previous night, you know?
Yeah.
And regardless of how light a singer is, the contact that we have at our chords, it's thousands of times, many thousands of times per night of singing. There is a tissue cost, and a certain amount of swelling that we're going to incur from that performance that is going to be felt the next day in the terms of that we can measure as swelling. And so you're constantly in this battle of how good do my chords feel? What can I do on them? What tricks am I going to play tonight? How careful am I going to be? How much am I going to use the microphone? And how much is my sound man my friend tonight? And how much are they my, you know, right. working against me? So there's so many things to think. You know, when we think about being a good singer, it's like, well, being a good singer once, or singing that song 10 times in a row because you're in the studio, or do you have to sing that song 8 times a week in the long run of a show, week after week, month after month? It changes how you sing things, you know. So we're always having to be flexible and always make decisions on our feet.
So sustained vocal health is clearly, you know, a priority. And I love yeah. that term that you used, the tissue cost.
Yeah.
There's going to be a tissue cost. And I think that's really important for us as performers to think about,
yeah.
You know, when the spirit moves us. And a lot of people actually, they want to express something that's in their soul that might feel that it has that much force. And a lot of singers really struggle with how to do that in healthy ways so that it feels like it's a natural expression. And that flexibility takes a lot of mindful study.
And mindful practice. I mean, reading a book and watching videos will get you to the starting line, maybe, you know, but
the hours have to go into the actual.
Yeah. The time. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I, you know, I have I spend most of my time now teaching and coaching, and for those people needing to make that journey to flexible so they can do the high flying trapeze vocal work, they have to start out on the ground. They don't start out high in the sky.
Yeah,
everything, you know, walking the high wire vocally requires that you learn how to do that. Just put a piece of tape on the ground. Can you walk across that piece of tape without falling? And if you can't do that, what are you doing trying to run across it at height with dancing girls hanging on a platform off your shoulders? I hope you like my visual that I've just created for you there. You know, but that's what I hear people trying to do, is people are trying to do yeah. too much, and they forego the delicate, quiet work of subtle coordination. Detailed coordination is where all the power lies. And people who just try to push it through their throat, that's a short game they're running there.
Right. Well, we're going to check out some of that subtle coordination right now. Friends, I hope you enjoyed this treat. This is like a really incredible video that you're about to see. We're just going to jump on into this. Here you go. Please enjoy this.
Singing in the MRI.
Singing in the MRI.
Singing in the MRI.
Singing in the MRI.
Hi, my name's Tyley Ross. I'm a singer, voice teacher, and vocologist in New York City. And using the magic of MRI technology, I want to show you what it looks like inside my head and neck while I'm singing. But first, let me warm up on a lip trill. How about a raspberry? Weird, right? Want to see that on an oo vowel? Now, before I go any further, let's try to figure out what it is we're actually seeing here. Let's go back inside and see if we can identify some of the features of the vocal tract. Lips, tongue. This difficult to control piece of anatomy is called the velum or the soft palate, but you can think of it as the nose gate. It opens and closes, controlling the flow of air and sound up into the nasal cavity. In most people, the velum is opening and closing constantly when we speak and sing, and we're barely even aware of it. Down here, we have the larynx, which houses the vocal folds. Now let's see what happens inside the vocal tract when we sing with contrasting singing strategies. I'm going to sing the end of Nessun Dorma, Puccini's great aria. I'm going to sing it in four different vocal styles. The first will be in a light mix. The second, in a forward-facing Broadway sound. The third, in a back-and-down operatic sound. And the fourth, in a style that will make Puccini roll in his grave, in a rock style.
I bet you do.
All'alba vincerò, vincerò, vincerò. All'alba vincerò, vincerò, vincerò. All'alba vincerò, vincerò, vincerò. All'alba vincerò, vincerò, vincerò. What you're looking at here are comparative images of the same vowel being sung at the same moment in each vocal style. This is a frozen moment showing my vocal tract singing the A vowel on a high B flat. Now, for those of you who are interested, that's the A, as in vincerò. Let's listen to it on a loop. Take a moment to see for yourself how the anatomical features of the vocal tract that we can see here align differently in each style. How is the tongue positioned differently? How about the velum? The mouth opening? How about the height of the larynx?
I just, at a certain point, I was doing all this editing myself on my laptop late at night after I put my son to sleep. So I just, you start making foolish creative decisions at a certain point.
Yeah, I had to leave that last part in.
I'm actually blushing. I haven't watched that in a while. It's
kooky. It's beautiful. It's beautiful. So now you were telling me a little bit about the making of this video. And could you just share a little bit? I mean, we've got so many videos that we want to watch. So just share a little bit about what we just saw and what some of the takeaways are that people can work with. And you said, you know, I get a lot of heat about this one, and I want you to address that too, because I was thinking about that myself. So tell us a little bit about this, Tyley.
Well, where do you want me to start?
You know, I think it's going to be fascinating for a lot of people to really discuss what just happened last, like the different positions of the velum, of the tongue, of the larynx in those different styles, and what that requires.
Yeah. So what I found interesting about that is that the same vowel, I mean, for those people who have studied speech or the IPA, the International Phonetic Alphabet, and who use that phonetic notation as a way to guide what vowels they're singing, are taught that a certain vowel lives at a certain place in your mouth, that the tongue height is in a certain quadrant of the mouth is going to dictate what vowel it is. And what I found really interesting, and I've always known, we talk about vowel modification all the time in singing, and it's a necessary piece, and maybe it's one of the most important things that we do. But I was just amazed how that what a singer in each one of those styles, like I wasn't trying to modify them. I was just living in a different style and a different strategy. And to then sit back and listen, but then also be able to see how different that vowel is audibly when you just line them up back to back. And then also just see them and just see that what is responsible for it. And they can be seen as slight differences, but when you consider that the differences in shape of the throat are attributable, can like a slight difference is going to be the difference between how we speak and how we sing grand opera, how we make all the sounds. They are just slight different contortions of all of the movable bits of this channel, this tube that we use to sing with. And I was just amazed to see all the things that are moving, particularly, I mean, I knew the tongue was going to be a big player. I knew the velum was going to be a big player. What I wasn't prepared for and what is becoming obvious to those of us lucky enough to spend some time learning from our own throats and in the fMRI machines is that the larynx height is a huge determinant of style. And that's not surprising to anybody who plays a wind instrument. The length of the wind instrument is what determines so much of the timbre of the instrument. And our instrument is measurable from where the sound leaves the front of our mouth, and that usually is the corner of the lips, where if our corner of our lips is the end of, whether we're round or spread, that's the end of the instrument. And then it goes down to, you know, takes a 90 degree turn, and it's about 15 centimeters in average, but you know, people are gonna be way above and way below that, but in adult larynxes. But I mean, I can just, you know, I can drop my larynx probably 2 or 3 inches and sing in that. So I can, you know, this is my resting position and I can put it down there. And then I'm a bigger instrument. I'm actually a longer instrument. And if you think that maybe I was 15, then now I'm like an 18 centimeter long instrument versus, and this is resting, and there's up in the top. So I can basically go from being a soprano sax to maybe a tenor or a baritone sax, depending on just where my larynx is being parked. And then there are whole styles of music that are possible if you can stabilize your larynx. And in classical singing, you know, there's a great bel canto tradition of lower larynx stabilization. And there are some great benefits, I think, particularly to young singers, regardless of what style they're going to be singing in, that they develop the ability to stabilize their larynx low, given that larynx, am I going far too into larynx speak? Is this,
this is wonderful. I think a lot of people watching have a fair idea of how to, they're probably mostly a cappella singers.
Okay, great.
So there is a tendency, I would say, for people singing in what other with bands or orchestras or a cappella, a tendency to have this idea that we have to over manipulate to get results. Like, even though you can drop the larynx that low, and you can maintain that, you know, in the bel canto tradition, the flexibility is really the key. The flexibility, yeah. And I think the fact that we don't have to force it to do that, there are easier ways to do that so that we don't come into too much muscular coordination.
Yeah, but my strong feeling is I want singers to be able to lower it. I want singers to be able to raise it.
Yeah.
So that they have, I mean, it makes me think of physical therapy, right? Like,
right.
We don't really know what our posture is unless we can touch our toes and unless we can lean back.
Right.
And so we don't really know where our larynx really wants to hang out and what is the optimal placement for it, unless we are capable of moving it high and keeping it low and being able to sing vocalises, you know, with a relative ease, relative stability, given there's always going to be some movement, but relative stability is going to be really important for people to develop. And I've had great results with singers just, you know, spending time on that. If the larynx is tracking up and down, you know, if back vowels and low notes mean a low larynx, and if front vowels and forward resonance and high notes means a high larynx, then that's got to be the first piece of work.
It's pretty
and then
much
once
about
that's
sensation.
Once
yeah
yeah, once that's stabilized, then a whole lot of things become possible.
Yeah. Well, we've got some. Now, this is going to be something we will have fun talking about after this. This is the magic of Don Walser. And this will be interesting to talk about what's happening vocally for performers such as this. This is just a clip, everybody, so please enjoy it.
They say a rolling stone never gathers, nobody says long, and it's rolling along. But I don't care if I gather little balls, it's in my Texas home. I got a little girl waiting, her name is Patricia Jane. I'll never be happy till I'm by her side, out on those West Texas plains.
In that, hanging out in that little restaurant.
Yeah.
So talk to us a little bit about yodeling.
Yodeling is basically when we're in chest voice. So yodeling is just oscillating really quickly or having a sudden break between.
Yeah, let's see that in the MRI, somebody says.
Between the chest. Well, actually, yeah. You wouldn't see it in the MRI necessarily because no. Actually this is one of the issues with fMRI is that, you know, we're only seeing it from this.
Yeah.
And because this is a recognizable view, if we actually looked at the larynx, an fMRI can see in three dimensions through the body, and you can choose which view you want. Mm. But the larynx, the vocal folds move way too fast for the MRI at this point. Give it a few years, they'll have it figured out, and we'll be watching vocal cords in MRI. But at this point, they can't take videos of it. But in the throat of a scope it, actually, there is some scoping of yodeling. One of the things about yodeling, a good yodeler, I mean, one of the things I love about Don Walser, I mean, the guy looks like, he doesn't even look like he's singing. It just, his mouth is everything's super stable. He's just so relaxed, which is one of the things I love in a singer, when they can really, they can put something like that out without doing a big gymnastic show with their body, you know. Mm. But the vocal folds in chest or mode one, the vocal folds are together. They oscillate like this. If you're scoping, then they look more like there's sort of the
swimming.
Yeah, swimming. Excellent. There's also, depending on how loud you're singing, from top of the vocal cords to the bottom of the vocal cords, they're coming together with more closure. So you can sing, people who are in the mix are most likely, you know, bringing a little bit more of a triangular kind of closure to the vocal folds. Mm. It's still oscillating like this, but when people are in a really thick chest, like an intense chest voice, or down in speech mode, then they're getting really square closure to their cords. When we flip into head voice, into falsetto, then it becomes a shutter action vibration to the vocal folds. Or you can't really do it with, but they go like this, as opposed to like this. The vocal folds don't quite come together. In some people's falsetto, they actually close, but in most people, they get close to closing and they don't really. So there's very little contact to the vocal folds, which means that they are freer to sing higher notes. It's easier to the action of the muscle of the the TA, the thyroarytenoid muscle that's actually in the vocal folds themselves, basically releases and gives way to the cricoarytenoid muscle, which is the external muscle, not quite external, it's internal to the larynx, but that pulls the vocal folds long and thin. So we become a thinner instrument, basically. But when we're yodeling, we're going back and forth between those two things. And in the case of Don Walser, I mean, it's Guinness record book stuff. I mean, he's going so fast between it. So if you're looking at the scope, you would see, you'd kind of want to see it scoping, but not just in slow motion like in strobe, but you'd want to slow it down to see that it's like, I wonder if I can, like they'd be pulling right apart, you get different thing.
That's a really great explanation of how yodeling works. And it's not just struggling to like jam, it, like your larynx is not jamming up. It's really, it's about the shape of the chords.
It needs to be stable. And in fact, for a lot of people who approach falsetto work with a high larynx, and they're trying to approach it with the kind of pressure that is involved with, they have a hard time getting their falsetto to work. Yeah, their head voice for, yeah.
Well, we're gonna switch over to Johnny Hallyday.
Oh, let me actually say, we actually have a couple of the, one of the things that Johnny Hallyday and Don Walser have in common is they were not, they sang their whole lives. In both of these videos, they were older men.
Yeah.
And these are voices that are driven really differently. But they both really still held it together. I think in this, Don Walser, I think he passed away very recently, if not in the last year. But he was, I think, in his 80s. Wow. And was singing right up to the end and singing well, you know. I think that video there was him in his 70s.
It's pretty amazing, though.
Like, yeah.
So relaxed and so chill and just like, this is what I do.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Which also actually says a lot about, you know, singers who maintain the health of their head voice. That really is a very healthy and important place for singers to be working. Mm-hmm. And those that don't maintain the head voice, I think of the... those who don't need to sing in head voice should be. And if they aren't, then it's the canary in the coal mine. It's a really great way to monitor more holistic vocal health. So for Don, he would have known all the time when he was in trouble. He would have a distant early warning system. It's like, the falsetto isn't working. I got to back out a little bit tonight. Whereas Johnny Hallyday, the great French, he brought rock and roll to France. He's basically the Elvis of France, and was singing in a very different way and was kind of bringing a little bit of rock, but also some a little bit more legit. And you'll see it's sort of rock verses and legit choruses. I just love this song. It's just so Euro. I just love it. Yeah.
Well, you know, I've got a soft spot for Euro. So, all right, yeah. Here we go. This is Johnny Hallyday.
Merci.
And still rocking the rock and roll threads too.
The suit is amazing.
Et les gens qui cherchent la lumière en pleine nuit. Les gens qui courent après l'amour et qui le fuient. Les voix qui seuls et pour un Dieu qu'il ne voit pas. Moi j'ai ta chair contre ma chair, en ça je crois. Que l'illusion d'attendre un signe. Des femmes qui pleurent leurs enfants, mais restent dignes. Toi tu me rends plus fort chaque jour, sans Dieu ni loi.
dans nos corps se font l'amour. Je sais pourquoi.
I especially love, I mean, it just sounds so important, right?
Yeah.
It's got so much gravitas. And I mean, you've got this huge chorus that sounds like Carmina Burana in the background.
He's amazing.
It's over the top. I love it.
I just love how he's just like walking around in this suit. Like, yeah, I clean the house this way. I'm just walking over here and letting this note come out.
That's it.
It's just so cash.
Yeah.
And it's so powerful. Yeah. And every now and then it's like, you know, he'll like do the gesture in his body, but his face and his upper body is just like totally like, I'm just breathing. I just have a note attached to it. It's so effortless.
Yeah. But you would know, I mean, a guy, I think in that video there, do you have the link up there? Is that like, it's the early 2000s or the mid 2000s,
right? Yeah, that
is
the early 2000s. Yeah.
So 15 years ago, I mean, I think he was early 60s there, I think. And I mean, most guys who are singing, guys and women who are singing that way, I mean, he's kind of mixing modes there to me. I mean, he's pushing a lot of weight, a lot of size. He's pushing up to his second passaggio and above and getting some good distortion up there. And that's fun to play with. But most young people who do that, thank you, Caleb. He was 74 when he passed. And to push weight up there that high, it's really intense on the chords. To go back to our new favorite term, tissue cost, it has a really high tissue cost to drive that kind of distortion at the level of the chords. And he's still able to do that, but you can hear that he's sort of the basic tone that he's using is a little bit of a, like a Barry tenor legit kind of size, but the expressivity and the You know, the onsets and the ornaments are all rock and roll, so you wouldn't mistake it, but it is kind of uniquely theatrical French. But then also when I was watching it there, like the way he says l'amour, sometimes it's pour l'amour, like he almost tilts it towards l'amour. Yeah, he's modifying. So yeah. I mean, he knows what he's doing. He's friends with his instrument, and I mean, somebody who works with it that long certainly would have to have made some negotiations with his throat over the years. You know?
No doubt. I'd like to know exactly how he kept himself in such good health singing with that much gravitas. Is really the word you used it perfectly.
Yeah.
For so many years. I mean, there is this overarching extended cost. You can strip your cords quite well if you don't take care along the way, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, actually stripping, that's actually a thing that they do to some people's cords. It's not recommended. It was a period when they thought this might be kind of cool. It turns out that lamina propria doesn't grow back on the cords, but anyway, but no, I mean, you basically driving it that hard, you raise the contact quotient, the amount, like the impact of the level of the cords per oscillatory cycle.
Right.
And there's a cost, the tissue cost. The body reacts by getting swollen. The swelling cycle reacts by building up fibrotic buildup there, reed nodules. It's basically the callusing process that we feel anywhere else in our throat, in our body. Is felt in our throat as nodules. You know, it's just telling you that you're just hitting them too hard, or too long, or you know, whatever. So God knows how we got through his career, there he was.
He looks pretty.
May we all be rocking in our 60s. You know,
right?
Yeah.
We all. Well, we're going to move on to some Broadway. Now, these are two distinctly different voices that work very well together.
Yeah.
I think you know who I'm going to introduce just by me saying that.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So let's just go in and take a
quick look. Well, let me just do a little preface here. This is Stephen Pasquale and Kelly O'Hara.
Right.
Stephen Pasquale is a great baritenor. We have one of our teachers is the same, so I get some inside scoop on what's going on in his throat there. Kelly O'Hara, who I've had the opportunity to brush shoulders with here in New York a few times, both just extraordinary performers. Kelly is a light, legit singer, and more from the classic Broadway tradition. Mm-hmm. Stephen Pasquale is really a dramatic voice, big voice. Interesting, he's an extremely technical singer. But all to the purpose of just a really passionate sound. You will see somebody featured in this video. It's Jason Robert Brown, sort of rocking away in the studio when he's as he's listening to his song be performed. I'm seeing a question here. When you say legit, do you mean classical operatic style? I mean, in the case of Kelly O'Hara, yeah, she's actually crossed over. I think she did a season at the Met or at. I mean, she's a really legit, she can handle a night on the operatic stage. And so she is about as close as you get to a really legit operatic singer, somebody with real operatic chops, singing in a Broadway show. And there aren't a lot of shows that allow for that. She is playing an Italian character in this, which allows her to use sort of Italian vowels. And she's actually doing an Italian dialect. That's not just a hangover from her bel canto training. So she's playing an Italian character. This is Bridges of Madison County. So check it out. I saw this and I felt like during this number, I was being levitated out of my seat. It really was a transporting moment in the theater.
This is a pretty cool piece. We're starting it a little bit in just, you know, in the interest of time for everybody who is interested. You won't be able to see the whole piece, but we're going to see most of it. And here we go.
Mo, you're at the wrong end of it. you want to come like 2 or 3 minutes in or something here?
Can't tell you I know what the future will be. Who knows anything? I just look at those eyes. You've got so much to see. Let me show you there's crowds and camels and hillsides to climb. All I know is in all of the time, from man's first breath to God's last warning, and I are just 1 second spinning by in 1 split second. You and I have just 1 second and 1,000,000 miles to go. I don't need something new.
I don't want to go back to a world without this.
All I've needed my whole life was you.
If I left this behind,
please just look at me. You were born with a wanderer's soul. This is how you begin to behold. The stars keep burning, worlds keep turning. Spinning by in just 1 second. You and I have just 1 second and 1,000,000 miles to go. Answer will be, it's impossible, but this thing, this is bigger than what we can see. This is destiny, we are tied, we are locked, we are bound. This will not be reversed or unwound, whatever fate the stars are weaving, we're not praying. Second, spinning by in just 1 second. You and I have just 1 second. Yeah.
we're just going to stop that there. And that is something amazing, is that
not? Oh, man.
Now, somebody mentioned in the chat, you know, and I was thinking this too, often we'll see vocalists that will seemingly have a lot of neck tension, but they're also working for some stability. You want to talk just a little bit about that for our folks that are watching?
Yeah, depending. I mean, there are maneuvers you can do. I mean, some, Steve Pasquale does this thing. He kind of lowers his, and I think that that's in the service of larynx lowering. Maybe for those who are into the idea of retraction of the laryngeal tube, you know, so basically pulling the energies and the structures, the tissues, the false vocal folds, the folds, away from each other. I think that's what he's doing there, because he definitely has what some people call a retracted sound, in terms of it's an open, it's a really open sound, right?
Yeah.
And at some moments to me, he sounds like he's country. Sometimes he sounds like a 1990s country singer, and sometimes like he's pushing a little bit of operatic sound, but it's not a weighty, it has the output of being a weighty voice. But he's remarkably sustainable. He churns that out night after night, and never misses a note.
Amazing.
That guy. Yeah. But you can watch
a lot of heat.
Yeah. 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 I did a reading of a play with him, and it was one of the most solid instruments, and he had some really hard work, but he had to do exactly the same face and body choreography all the time. Hmm. You know, this ease of voice comes from, you know, you have to do something to make that happen.
Yeah. Character too. Like when you're character driven, our voice, I don't know about, I'm sure you know, but my voice seems to do a lot of things when I feel an authentic character wanting to push it. And if I'm in good vocal health, I have a better shot of actually achieving what it is that that character wants to say.
Yeah. And actually a big part of what I do with my clients in the theater world is, well, that thing that your character is trying to say is going to blow your throat out. So is there something else that we can, do you have another choice? Do you have another way of saying it that actually might be a more powerful way of saying it? That doesn't cost you that same thing.
Exactly. Exactly. That's the trade.
Yeah. Somebody said, reminds me of Chris from Miss Saigon. He was one of the Chris's in Miss Saigon. So was I.
So was Tyley, friends.
Yeah, so we were veterans of the same vocal thrashing, playing that role on Broadway. Yeah.
The Chris's of Miss Saigon.
Yeah. We once actually, it's one of the only places where this is interesting to talk about. I was at a party while I was playing Chris in Miss Saigon. This is going 25 years ago. But I was at a party. It was a Saigon party.
Right after that. That's
right. That's right.
When I
that's
met
right.
You had just come
and, and in one corner, current and former Chris's all got together to just talk about. And it was like a therapy group of which moments of the show were killing us and which moments exposed us and which moments made us want to quit singing altogether. It really was. It was a thrashing sing, but it was great to actually get together with the only people who kind of understood what it was you're going through, you know.
He was one of those guys. Saigon. That's killing me a little bit. I want to see this. I think it could be like a bit that you guys get together and do.
Right. Yeah. Only for the people here, though. I think they'd get it. You guys would get it.
It'll be amongst us. We'll get it.
Yeah.
Put it out to an unlisted link for us only.
Yeah. But let me just say one other thing. In terms of external movements and tensions.
Yes.
If the tensions don't, like, I will do a lot of like jaw tightening and tongue tightening if it's going to involve, if I'm going to be doing singing with a really high laryngeal position, which isn't what I'm always going to be doing, but if that's what I'm trying to make happen, then you're going to see a lot of extrinsic muscular tension. But that tension does not necessarily correlate with tension at the level of the fold. So when we get tired as singers, there's a bunch of different ways we can get tired, right? Like some music is going to burn our brain.
Right.
It's going to be really difficult. And so we're going to get mentally tired. Some music is just so emotionally taxing that we're just, I mean, our heart's going to get tired. The vocal folds, the tissue can get tired. And that usually is what most of us feel when it's like, no, I'm tired. And it's actually, no, your muscles could still do it. It's just the tissues that you use need some time to regenerate and recuperate and to get happy again before they can sing. And then there's muscular tiredness. So if I'm doing like a really high, if I'm singing up here and I have to keep it light, I mean, I could sing all day on my chords like that, but it involves, I mean, my tongue gets really tight, that gastric muscle really tight, the elevator muscles really tight, and that's going to be seen as, you know, some extra work.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Steven Tyler.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's not light singing what he's doing.
No, that's
and
not light
we
singing.
Know that that voice has been under the knife a few times. So, I mean, he's done everything possible to not take care of that voice, and it works, yeah, you know, nonetheless. I don't know how he does or how he did it. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we have very little time left, but we're going to play this last clip.
I told you we were going to run out of time.
I
told you I have a lot of things to say.
I'm unsurprised. we are going to maybe end a minute over time, but this is worth it. I believe you were in the audience for this, were you not?
Oh, are we talking about Color Purple?
Yes.
Yeah, Cynthia Erivo. Yes. This was at this moment in the show. I wasn't familiar with the show. I didn't know what to expect. Everybody was talking about what an extraordinary performance it was, but I had to put my hands over my mouth to keep myself from letting out spontaneous vocalisms that had nothing to do with either applause or singing. It brought me to a primal place, and it remains the most extraordinary thing I've witnessed, maybe at all.
Right.
I mean, certainly in a theater, it's shocking, and even to see it here, yeah.
You know, yeah, I can't get enough of this, I got to tell you. So we're going to treat people this. We're going to wrap it up afterwards, so you'll have a chance to speak a little bit afterwards.
All right.
Let's just jump right on into this. Right? Like, I got nothing.
It's just...
Now, that is one of those moments. It's like, this song was written for this person.
Well, and it wasn't actually. She did the revival of it, but
exactly.
I mean, she just... It,
but like in the big universal scope of things, it's like the universe knew this was going to happen.
This person was going to come along and sing the song. And I don't know. I know that it cost her a lot to do that 8 times a week, and it was really hard on her, but man, she did that. She ran it in England and then on Broadway. I mean, just what a Herculean effort. And I just think whatever she paid, I know that she would have probably lived no life outside of her show in order to do that. But what an act of generosity from a performer to an audience to be able to pull that out. Just
and it has to be said.
Extraordinary.
It has to be said, like socially, that has to happen. That her singing that song has to happen.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Tyley,
kind of,
I hate to say this. We are out of time, but the good news is that I am absolutely certain on our next series of Performance Feast, you will come back and we will go further and deeper.
I'm here for you, Mo.
I love you, pal.
Yeah, love you too. Hey, thank you to everybody else here. Let me just look in the chat, make sure everybody's talking about Cynthia Erivo. Yes,
no words.
Yeah, people who don't believe in magic are lying to themselves. Yes.
I want that on a t-shirt.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you,
Hey, listen, it's been great chatting with you all. I hope that was useful and fun, and what a lucky group you are to have Mo Field in your universe. Yeah, she's a true joy, and speaking of magic, she is magic in mind. So thank you, Mo.
Tyley. It's great to have you here, my friend. So friends, thank you for supporting Tyley Ross. You can, you know, go and support him further from this as well. Please do and spread the word. And we'll see you next week. We have returning by special request, Jennifer Scott. Actually, Jennifer and Tyley and I were in a modern opera together many years ago, which we were talking about earlier. But Jennifer Scott's coming back next week. And Tyley, again, thank you so much.
Yeah,
really
thank you.
It.
All right.
And now
take
Magic
care.
Voice is going to take us out. Please stick around. We have some Final words for Magic Voice.
Thank you so much, Tyley and Mo, for a great performance piece. Give it up for Tyley and Mo, everybody. I am, please take a moment to fill out our simple poll. I just launched it right now. And please take the time to follow us on Facebook and YouTube at The Great Northern Union and on Instagram and Twitter at GNU Sings. The series has been made possible by the voters of Minnesota through a grant from the Minnesota State Arts Board, thanks to a legislative appropriation from the Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund. Again, this has been GNU Presents Performance Feast. Feed your mind and nourish your heart.